Welcome back to the PFC podcast. The views and opinions you are about to hear are the speakers and do not necessarily reflect those of anyone else. Now on to the podcast.
All right, so last podcast we heard from Sean Keenan, head of the Prolonged Field Care Working Group, and basically just got an intro to PFC and where we're going with this thing. So this first real podcast where we're talking about actual operational medicine issues, I got a great topic for us. All right, so we're going to focus on one of the best pieces of kit for prolonged field care, and it happens to be super cheap and totally underestimated and overlooked, and that is the ability to measure urine output. I think I can speak for a lot of the soft medics out there that have done emergency room rotations. When we think of putting in a Foley, we think of it as this emergency room thing that just is one of those things that happens when a patient comes in, and it's one of those ugly jobs that we all volunteer to do so that we can be part of that trauma team when we're initially doing hospital rotations. And I don't think we put a lot of thought into just how useful measuring urine output really is. So it's our intention with this podcast to give you a quick solution for prolonged field care that's not super expensive and is totally within your scope of practice and is pretty safe to do in the field environment. If you go to the WordPress site, prolongedfieldcare.org, and check out some of our recommendations and our white papers that are on there, you'll see a section called 10 PFC capabilities. And one of those capabilities that's required for prolonged field care is simply monitoring. And obviously there's varying levels of monitoring, but what we're offering you with this is at a basic level, any soft medic, you know, any provider that's out there in a remote setting should be able to get a lot of hemodynamic stability information from their patient without a whole lot of cost and without a whole lot of bulky equipment. And, you know, once you hear these docs talk about what you can get from a BP cuff, stethoscope, pulse ox, and a Foley catheter kit, you're going to be pretty confident deploying forward without having a lab set with you. Obviously, other pieces of equipment would be great. It would be nice to have an iStat. It would be great to have the ability to do field labs, but there's logistical issues with that. So by no means are we saying that labs in the field are irrelevant, because that is a current capability that we can bring forward. But I think before we go spending our money on equipment, we should make sure that we have this essential kit that really doesn't cost us anything. And if you go to prolongedfieldcare.org and look for the monitoring section, you're going to see a Word document on there that you can download that has a description of all the different catheterization products that are out there. And I know that's probably the last thing anybody wants to read, but it's important to learn the terminology of what these things are so you order the right pieces of equipment, because we're not talking about an in and out cath. We're not talking about a Texas condom cath. We're talking about an indwelling Foley catheter kit. And guys always have questions about what the right size is. And this document is going to give you all the information that you need in order to order the right equipment. All right, so one more thing we need to address before the talk begins is sterility. One of the working group members, Doc Rush, who's the head physician for the pararescue guys, he contacted me and said, hey, some people are under the impression that a Foley doesn't need to be a sterile procedure, and that's probably not a good idea. And we as the working group agree 100%. I think in TC3, we got away with a few things that are normally sterile, and saying, well, in combat conditions, it probably doesn't need to be sterile. But this is a different story. In prolonged field care, we are trying to reduce morbidity, and that means we got to pay attention to the infection thing. So we're not saying this needs to be a hospital-style sterile procedure. However, it needs to be as close to that as you can possibly make it. So there's no easy answer for this one, and if you have any opinions on this, if there's a urologist out there who's listening who wants to weigh in on whether this needs to be super sterile or as sterile as possible, please let us know. So go to prolongedfieldcare.org and send us a comment on that. I think this has been overlooked in our community for a long time, especially with all the technology that's out there available to us. I think we've been seeking answers like field labs instead of going for a tried and true cost-effective solution to monitoring hemodynamic status like the Foley catheter. So this whole talk for about the next 20 minutes is centered around this topic of monitoring hemodynamics with a Foley. And I asked these guys, two doctors that I'm about to interview, I asked them about, what's the bare minimum that they see necessary to monitor a patient in a prolonged field care setting. So they talk about that for a bit. And they end up, the conversation ends up morphing into a talk about hypotensive resuscitation and how long you can actually leave a patient, in a low flow state of say an 80 systolic, for example. So you're going to hear initially from Dr. Phil Mason, who's an Air Force emergency medicine physician, is also a critical care intensivist. And the second guy you're going to hear from is Dr. Chris Burns. So Chris is a trauma surgeon, did a burn fellowship at the ISR, and he's currently working out of Boston. He retired from the Navy last year. So you're going to hear two different perspectives on what urine output means to the soft medic. All right, so here's Dr. Mason, who's going to answer my question here, and it got cut off a little bit at the beginning. My question to him was, what's your take on the Foley catheter being a prolonged field care monitoring device?
It is your best barometer of how is the whole body doing. So if the urine output is decent, then probably the intestines are perfused well. Things are most likely perfused well. Okay. Or it's your best indicator in the absence of any really high tech things that life is good for the whole organism. And all the hemodynamic variables out there kind of get boiled down into urine output. If the circulatory system is in relatively good shape, then there will be some degree of urine output. If it's not, then there won't be. And I'm obviously ignoring people who have direct injury to the kidney, because in this setting, you're just not going to know that. Setting of normal kidneys, I can get a very good handle on whether or not you need more fluid or less fluid, whether or not your blood pressure is too low or whether or not it's doing just fine based on how much urine's coming out every hour. The risk is near zero. There's just no reason not to do it. That's probably at least half the inputs for our decision-making in people in the ICU back home is urine output. I mean, it's commonly talked about with burn patients, but the truth is it applies to everybody. It is the way to get it's the simplest way to get a good handle on what's the hemodynamic status of the patient. God, because you have no idea how much fluid somebody has lost or is continuing to lose. If a guy bled a certain amount under the ground, you might make a stab at how much that is. But all this third space fluid, let's say a guy's got cholera or has some GI, and you don't know how much fluid they're losing through their GI tract, what their insensible losses are, if they have fever, what they're exhaling. You have no way of measuring any of that, but you can get a feel for it all by following what comes out through in the urine. So I think it's money. Between that and a non-invasive blood pressure cuff and a stethoscope, you can get an enormous amount of hemodynamic data with, nothing that's even remotely technologically difficult or, high tech.
So do you say, half cc per kilogram per hour? Is that the magic number?
Yeah, that's right. That's fine. And most people, you could round it to maybe 30 to 50 cc's an hour, half a cc per kilo, something like that. In most patients, if the urine output is a lot more than that, it's probably not harmful. It might be in some, in burns, abdominal compartment syndrome, that stuff, it might be harmful, or it might let you know that you're giving the patient an amount of fluid that may actually be doing harm. It certainly is not doing any good. So at a minimum, you can conserve the limited IV fluid you have, by cutting them back. And in certain cases, probably do the patient more good by paying attention to the upper bounds of your normal urine output as well as the lower. So yeah, half a cc per kilo per hour, 30 cc's, 30 to 50 an hour, something like that are all kind of ballpark things. We have a nice urimeter, but you don't need that. If you have a friggin' water bottle or something, you can dump it into and just make a little mark on it. I mean, it doesn't have to be high tech to keep track of what the urine output's doing every hour.
Come up with a useful trend, and we're talking to you on the phone with this patient in front of us. So is hourly what you're looking for?
Yeah, it's hourly. Now, some ICUs will go to doing it every 2 hours, just so you don't find yourself like chasing your tail. You make an intervention, and before it can even change, you're making another adjustment. On the other hand, if you're 40 minutes into the hour and there's no urine output, well, then there's no reason to wait for the full hour to go by before you make a change. But yeah, I mean, breaking down every hour is a reasonable starting point. 2 hours might be appropriate in some cases.
Okay, just a few quick points the working group wanted to add in at this point. First off, we just need to put out there to everybody, it may seem like common sense, but any urine output from the initial Foley placement doesn't count towards your urine output for the hour. So once there's an injury, you place the Foley, whatever goes into that bag from point of injury doesn't count. So you need to empty the bag and start from scratch. The second thing is we're looking for an honest hour of urine output. So we can't just measure for 15 minutes and then multiply by four to get your hour. You have to do a full on hour, just like Phil was talking about. You know, even 2 hours is a decent measurement. Additionally, when we're actually talking about what Foleys we're using, we're not talking about an in and out catheter. We're talking about an indwelling Foley. And the collection bag is key here. Usually in the Army system, we just have the Foley kits that have just a regular bag, and they don't have a urometer on the outside, which is the plastic container that'll give you, you know, down to the ML, what the output is. So if you can pick those things up, if you don't have those in your system, then you're going to have to empty the bag out into some kind of graduated cylinder or a syringe that's going to break it down by ML so you can get an hourly output. Because remember, we're talking about maybe only 30 to 50 cc's an hour. So it's essential that we actually get a accurate measurement. All right, the next comments are going to be from Chris Burns, the surgeon. So you're going to see a little bit different perspective from him as opposed to Phil, who's an emergency physician. But this conversation is about to morph into a discussion on hypotensive resuscitation. So this will be a longer discussion in a further podcast.
To talk about, you know, putting in a Foley catheter, you know, some people with narcotics, some people with pain, they've got difficulty emptying their bladder. So it's not, in addition to measuring someone's hemodynamics by looking, or getting a sense of their hemodynamics by looking at their urine output, there are just reasons to decompress somebody's bladder. Okay. So even in a patient who's really stable, who their urine output, quite frankly, is not that important, there are still many indications to put a Foley catheter in a trauma patient. Again, that's to decompress their bladder for someone who cannot pee on their own. Okay. So that's, and you and I have seen that, you know, firsthand on a previous deployment. But make no mistake about it, you know, post-procedural, pain-related and medication-related, people may have difficulty urinating. They may even be able to get some urine out, but they may not be able to empty their entire bladder. Over a period of time, that urine is going to eventually, you know, continue to fill their bladder. And although you think they're peeing a little bit out, they're not emptying their bladder. Now, if they empty it somewhat, that's probably fine. But just recognize a Foley catheter is not only a marker of their hemodynamics.
You know, hypotensive resuscitation or permissive hypotension is kind of the, you know, that's the language everyone speaks. And there's this generalized fear of giving fluids because we're going to blow out some clots. And I think that we need to make this conscious shift to, now we're in a prolonged field care setting where, you know, we're not talking about, you know, we're in tactical field care for a number of hours. We're talking, hey, we're not leaving till tomorrow. You know, how long can I leave this guy in this low flow state, you know, with a systolic of 80? Because I'm assuming that if we keep him like that, we're not going to get that urine output. Is that a fair assumption?
Yeah, I have no idea what to do with hypotensive resuscitation when there is no option of getting to a surgical facility. I have no idea. I mean, everybody talks about it. It's definitely a grand concept, but we only know that it happens to be pretty nice when there's a surgeon waiting on the other end of some transport, you know. When that transport is really long, I have no idea what to do with it. It's probably reasonable to try to titrate the blood pressure to some point where you have urine output, you know, at a certain level, and probably not go beyond that. I don't know. You know, give them enough fluid to get a urine output of 30 cc's an hour and just ride it out. I really don't know. You know, I have no idea what the answer is. But I agree, if you have a blood pressure of 80 because of acute bleeding, you probably are going to have a low urine output. I mean, I think it's pretty reliable that that's going to be detected in the urine output. But frankly, you'll see some people with a normal blood pressure and they're going to have low urine output because their flow is still low. And that's why urine output is such a good window into what's really going on behind the blood pressure. But yeah, I don't know what to do with hypotensive resuscitation, really. I mean, it's definitely all the rage and it makes perfect sense to me, but I don't know at what point you turn that off or start compromising on that because it's not sustainable indefinitely.
hypotensive resuscitation is a range. That doesn't mean poor resuscitation. That means you're just resuscitating them less than their body normally sees. So it's, 80 to me is very low. Now, the difference between 80 and 90, I don't really know what that is. But then the difference between 80 and 70, I don't know what that is. And I'm certainly not comfortable with the prolonged systolic blood pressure of 70. 80 is kind of this nebulous thing. And obviously, we talk about 90 and return of pulses and things like that. But my thing is when you do hypotensive resuscitation, you are, robbing Peter to pay Paul. You are saying that you're going to have probably global hypoperfusion, which is putting your brain, your lungs, your kidneys, your heart, your coronary vessels, your GI tract, everything at risk in an attempt to get that patient to a surgeon who can plug the hole. Because if you had a patient who bled a lot from a tourniquet, but you put the tourniquets on, they're now hemostatic. As far as I'm concerned, I don't recommend this, but you can get their blood pressure to 120 over 80. They're no longer bleeding. So if you're concerned about a patient, I think of hypotensive resuscitation for someone who is probably still bleeding, or at least you don't have good hemostatic control on that patient. Or maybe you've got a femoral vessel that's been packed, but if you bring up the blood pressure too much, then that packing will no longer stay. So the concept of hypotensive resuscitation is short term, because if the patient is still bleeding, you've got to give that patient volume to perfuse other organs, or their global ischemia is going to kill them, is going to do them more harm than blowing out that clot. I mean, if they're still bleeding, they need a surgeon. And if you're not going to get them to a surgeon and they're still bleeding, they are likely going to die. And I think keeping the blood pressure at 80 or 90, probably not that big of an issue. The issue is you have a bleeding trauma patient. That is the issue.
No, I agree. I mean, if the surgeon's 1 hour away, fine. I don't care if you give him fluid or not, as long as he's awake. But at some point, you're going to have to adjust your strategy. And I think that, mentation is, it's all you got sometimes, man. But it's a crappy measure, because that's the last thing to go. I mean, every physiologic mechanism in your body is designed to maintain blood flow to your brain. So by the time you stop mentating or start having combativeness or altered mental status from shock, you're really, really in deep trouble. It's a late finding. So obviously, for a prolonged field care setting, it's probably not going to be the appropriate titration point. It's one of them, but urine output's probably a more sensitive indicator of what the overall hemodynamic status is than mentation. Because you can be in really bad trouble and mentate okay, And by the time your mentation goes, you're really off the, you're in hot water.
And I think that would be a nice, bringing in the iStat, that would be nice to know lactate 12, 6 hours out, because I don't know, as I said, my guess is if you had a systolic of 80 for 12 hours, my suspicion is, man, your gut's going to be pretty close to going and your lactate's going to be high and all this other stuff. If it turns out it isn't, fantastic. But that, urine output plus a lactate after a certain amount of time, we'll just call it 6 hours, I think could be, could be very useful in the letting you know whether that patient needs more fluids. Again, showing that you can't just talk kidney. I mean, we're trying to put everything on kidneys, but just like the lungs, we're talking, all this stuff works together. So when the kidneys aren't working, we're suspecting that other things aren't working. That may not necessarily be the case, but at least it's a good indicator that you're at least heading the right direction.
In addition to the Foley catheter, I think just a simple non-invasive blood pressure cuff and a stethoscope, if you add that to the mix, you got pretty good monitors. You can get a good feel for what's going on. That's, again, probably something most guys aren't carrying, and for good reason. It has no role in the TCCC guidelines, and I agree with that. But probably something else, a mission essential equipment list would include a blood pressure cuff, for a prolonged setting.
All right. Like I said, that kind of morphed into a hypotensive resuscitation in conjunction with prolonged field care kind of discussion. So I think that's going to warrant some further discussion on a later podcast. So we'll try to bring Chris Burns back to talk about that some more and see if anybody else has some comments on those topics. So again, if you have any questions or comments, please go to prolongedfieldcare.org and let us know what you think. and thanks for listening.
For today's podcast, be sure to go to our website, www.prolongfieldcare.org. Find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram. Subscribe and stay on the bleeding edge of combat medicine. This is Dennis for the PFC Podcast. Out. Boy is waiting there for you.